Well, hello and welcome to the June 16, 2024 online sermon from Christian Fellowship Church. Christian Fellowship Church, located in Northwest Indiana, is Hammond's Bible Church. Use the contact information at the end of this video to either call us, email us, go to the World Wide Web, check out our blogs, check out other information we have there as well. You can either get our podcasts, which are very similar to these videos, but do come from the morning messages. June 16th is Father's Day, and we will have donuts for dad. So if you're in the area and this video is maybe aired a little early, you think, wow, I would like to get a donut and celebrate with other fathers, please come and be a part of our ministry. We have a lot going on this summer, and I've been exhorting the viewers of this video to regularly be praying for our outreach with the soccer outreach coming in July 15th through the 19th. Once again, Hammond has been very, very gracious to us and allow us to use Edison Park, and we're looking forward to another great soccer outreach. We pray that we have over 100 young people attend nightly. We're going to be giving a message on fathers here in a second, but first we're going to transition in and out of our music ministry.
Good morning. Welcome to Christian Fellowship Church.
Right. Yeah.
Father's Day 2024. That is when this message is initially going to air, June 16th, 2024. When we think about fathers and honoring fathers, we know that the scriptures tell us in Ephesians chapter 6 that we are to honor our parents, our mother, and our father, but specifically in light of the fact that it's Father's Day, we recognize that this is something we're going to be doing 365 days a year, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. It is a regular habit for the believer to honor father as well as mother. But when we think about Father's Day, it is a holiday that is cultural. We've got to always keep that before us. It is a holiday that the American people started officially celebrating back in 1910. I believe June 19th was the first Father's Day. And I always point out Mother's Day was years before. I think the first one was May 12th, 1907 for mothers. But nonetheless, we honor fathers and mothers in our culture. And I think that's a good thing, to give them a special day. And because of that, it makes me think that I need to give a special message. And it's something that's always a little bit of a struggle, because when you look in the Bible, there's never a perfect father, really. Looking at the Old Testament, I was contemplating the patriarchs, the fathers from the Old Testament, like Abraham, Moses, David. None of them had perfect track records. One of the godliest men in the Old Testament, Daniel, you don't have any record of him having children. Hosea, godly man, prophet, married to a prostitute, does name his children, but even that is a little bit challenging, the naming of his children. So when you look at the Old Testament, like I said, there isn't this model family. In the New Testament, there's not much written about specific families. We see a few families where the household gets saved, and that's exciting, but we don't know the specifics of that household. And we also have somebody like Timothy, who's a godly young man, but we get more information about his mother and grandmother than we do his father. We really don't know what happened to his father and the level of influence his father had on him. We wish we had examples of others, perhaps like the apostles, and I was contemplating that in preparation for this message, thinking, wow, we don't know anything about how the apostles, you would think that they would be a model example for us if God wanted us to focus on that. And maybe there's this little concept here about not focusing on the family. The idea, when we talk about the apostles, church history does give us a little insight into them, even though it's not mentioned in the scriptures. We know that they were, that at least some of them were married according to the New Testament, but it's church history that tells us about some of their children. And I found one of the most interesting ones this week that I will show a picture from the catacombs in Rome. And I've had the opportunity of being in several of the catacombs. And there's often drawings down there that depict individuals, Bible scenes. And from the catacomb in Rome, one of the catacombs in Rome, I think it's called, it's the catacomb of Domitia in Rome, there is a picture of a young woman named Petronella. And why that's significant is that she is supposedly the daughter of Peter, and a woman that gets martyred for her faith. The second century writer Clement of Alexander wrote, Peter and Philip fathered children, and Philip gave his daughters in marriage. And then another new early church father, Ignatius, wrote, the disciple of who was a disciple of the Apostle John, said, for I pray that, being found worthy of God, I may be found at their feet in the kingdom, as at the feet of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, as of Joseph and Isaiah and the rest of the prophets, and as of Peter and Paul and the rest of the apostles that were married men. For they entered into these marriages not for the sake of appetite, but out of the regard for the propagation of mankind. So there is some history that the apostles did have children, but not in the scriptures. If anyone would have scripture reference, it would be perhaps Judas. I'm not going to turn there, but Psalm 109 would allude to Judas's children. And it's not a pretty sight what happens to his children because of judgment that comes upon the family. So that's Psalm 109 if you're interested in that. When I look at the idea of fathers, it is something that, again, we have this holiday culturally, and it impacts our culture. And I came across a whole series of quotes that were very inspirational in regards to how impactful a father is and how impactful the role is. And I thought I'd read a few of these because it shows how even the unbelievers recognize the role of a father, even though we're going to talk about culturally, the unbeliever doesn't understand this, the same role that the Bible does for a father. But there's an unknown quote that says, "Dad, a son's first hero, a daughter's first love." And there is a lot of truth to that when the dad is in the home and he's active and he's involved in his children's lives. Then go through a series of people that are very secular, very ungodly. Mike Myers, an actor, said, "Anyone who tells you fatherhood is the greatest thing that can happen to you, they are understating it." And I think many believers would echo that as well. David Beckham, the former professional soccer player, footballer from the European perspective, said, "In my career, there are many things I've won and many things I've achieved, but for me, my greatest achievement is my children and my family." And again, we would echo that as well. I've got quotes from Michael Bublé, the musician, Ron Baratano, the author, Chris Pratt, the actor, John Legend, the musician, Kevin Costner, the actor, all with the similar concept, how great it is to be a father. Let me just give you one other. Ken Norton, professional boxer, said, "Of all the titles I've been privileged to have, Dad has been the best." And again, I would say many believers would echo that as well. And then a man who doesn't honor God, I think, in his TV, in his comedy, a man named Seth Meyers said, "It's so embarrassing how I went from a person who did not care about anyone's children. Then you have them, and then you brag about the same stuff that you never cared about. And you tell people he's got four teeth, like they care." All right? Well, let me give you one from Billy Graham. Billy Graham, godly man. "The greatest tribute a boy can give to his father is to say, when I grow up, I want to be just like my dad." So we can see from a cultural perspective, unbelievers get it. The role of a dad is very special. It is very important. But none of those responses were so much on a father's responsibility. And when you start looking at the biblical responsibilities of a father, that's really lost in our culture. Whether it's the media, newspaper, newsprint, television shows, movies, there seems to be an agenda to really downplay the role or eliminate the role of what a biblical father is. And sadly, I would even say today, you have to be very cautious of Christian schools. I don't find too many Christian schools espousing the biblical role of a father and mother. I'm talking college or the Christian schools that are from high school, junior high, elementary, because there is, I think, too much influence of the world, and Christian schools are often money-driven, and so therefore they're not going to stand up when our culture is pushing back. So just have to pray for our Christian schools. That's what I would tell you, especially colleges. But when we look at looking for the ideal family, like I said, there's no perfect family really given in the Bible. And perhaps maybe that is because God wants us to have a really realistic understanding that the world is fallen. And you know, when I deal with people in our church family, everyone's got problems. Everyone's got difficulties in their family. And that's more realistic. So I think maybe if we would have had like what is typically called the Norman Rockwell family, it would have been kind of discouraging. Like, here's the perfect family. When in reality, we don't know anyone that has that. It's very few and far between where they have that Norman Rockwell kind of approach. But it still doesn't mean we don't focus on what a dad is supposed to be. And we're going to talk today about honoring dads and looking at the like at least five key traits that fathers have that make us love them, make us honor them. And I'm hoping that as we talk about this will inspire dads to be more like what God wants, as well as to inspire people to be praying for their fathers and then to properly give them the honor they want. We know that it's important to have a father in the home, but even research will back that up. One research group polled thousands of families and churches, and they recently discovered the following facts, that when a mom is a regular churchgoer, dad attends infrequently, okay? And when mom is a regular churchgoer, but dad attends infrequently. Only 3% of their children go on to become involved with church as adults. Only 3%. But if dad is the regularly regular church goer, and he's regularly involved, whether or not mom even attends, 44% of the kids end up involved in church when they become adults. So it's important that we have godly fathers. And so if you have your Bible, turn to 1 Corinthians 11, and let's just go through five of these traits. I've got five traits, and the first one comes from 1 Corinthians 11, where the Apostle Paul says in verse 3, but I want you to understand that Christ is the head of every man, and the man is the head of a woman, and God is the head of Christ. And he's working through different roles and responsibilities in 1 Corinthians 3, and it's a chapter that we've done some extensive studies on. I would encourage you to get the podcast, because it does talk about, I think, a literal head covering when you have a woman who's a prophet. But not going down that path right now, just talking about the fact of leadership. And if you have sermon notes, which I email out to the church, if you're someone who's watching this video, email the church and we'll send you this for the June 16th broadcast. Fill in the blank that dads are leaders, especially in spiritual matters. That when the Apostle Paul is talking about headship here, he's talking about leadership. And he's not just talking about in the church, he's talking about in families. And the context of male-female roles is with headship here. Now, leadership, headship, means that you're not just this authoritative boss. You are someone that's taking initiative, you're making decisions, you're getting involved, you're leading, you're directing your family. Today, we live in a culture, like I said, that really downplays the role of a father. But this is what God wants. And then on top of that, our culture is also being always very critical of leadership. Leadership in the political realm, leadership in business. And it just becomes very critical. And I believe sometimes that carries into the church as well as the families, how people are very critical of leadership. And so on top of that, when you've got television fathers regularly being portrayed as buffoons, there's this mindset that you have that leader is not being respected. We hope that we will see our fathers be leaders, especially in spiritual matters, and it will cause them to be respected. Four actions that can help every dad. You can jot these down. Number one, I believe a father should be in the Word. If you're on the Word regularly, it's going to impact you to have a godly mindset when you make decisions, when you take initiative. Two, very important that a father serves somewhere in the church. We're all told to serve. We're all given spiritual gifts. Everyone should be able to serve. Serving, it models that initiative that you're taking. God is important, and it's a sacrifice of time. So dads, serve somewhere. Three, regularly pray for your family. We're seeing in Matthew 6 the fact that we are to be daily, I believe, praying. And my mindset then is, I'm going to pray for myself. I'm praying for my family. Fight for your family. And as I've talked about putting on spiritual armor from Ephesians 6, the reality of Ephesians 6 is that part of the mechanism that makes the spiritual armor work is prayer. So pray and then take initiative. Number four. So number one is being the Word, serve somewhere, pray for your family. But fourth is take initiative. Your family is waiting for you to say, let's go to church. Let's pray about this. Let's serve here. And when you do that, you make an incredible impact. There's a sermon I ran across this week by a pastor named Roger Thompson. It's called Becoming a Man. And in it, he said this: what is the most powerful word in the English language? Is it honor or love or country? Maybe it's sacrifice. He quotes a man named Stu Weber, who has written the book called Tender Warrior, who says, how about the word dad? Just walk through what you know about life. When it comes to power in a youngster's world, I'll put my money on the word dad. As words go, hope, vision, sacrifice don't mean a lot to little ones, but the power of the word dad reaches far beyond a youngster's childhood. In fact, it spans generations. These are two ways to recognize power. One is to see it work. The other is to measure what happens when it's gone. Either way, the word dad is pretty potent. Present or absent, positive or negative, the power of the father is incredible. And so I believe that's true. And he continues on and he talks about in Ramsey County, Minnesota, 9th and 10th graders were interviewed recently about their dads, and they were asked this question: when it comes to mind, what do you think of when you hear the word dad? And answers came immediately from both ends of the spectrum. One end of the spectrum said, I think of the word jerk. Others thought the words angry, mad, and absent. On the other hand, some of the young people said, I think of wholeness, kindness, security, safety. The author goes on to say, dad is an immensely powerful word. A father leaves an indelible mark on the soul, life of the soul, the life of the children and grandchildren. It may be damaging, it may be enabling, it might be powerful, but it is incredible that the most powerful human position is conferred upon men who are fathers. And I hope we always remember that. Now I'm going to have you turn to one other passage in this subject of fathers being leaders. If you look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, as the Paul is giving a series of instructions as he wraps up 1 Thessalonians, he says in verse 12, but we request of you, brethren, that you appreciate those who diligently labor among you and have charge over you in the Lord and give you instruction, and that you esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Live in peace with one another. Well, there are three commands that are directed toward leadership, and you know, it could be pastors, elders, but it's also, I believe, has an application for fathers. Those are the ones who lead. And the three things are, number one, acknowledge them. There's a sense where you recognize their position. You acknowledge them as people who have to give account for how they led you. And that's what fathers have to do. And so you're listening to them when you acknowledge them. Number two, you esteem them. The word for esteem here is a composite of three words. A literal translation means beyond, exceedingly, abundantly. There is a sense where you convey that they're important. So when they're doing things to lead you, you're recognizing that you need to pay attention and heed them and not treat them as the buffoon that the world portrays a father as. And then third is love. It comes from the Greek word agape. It's the kind of act of the will. It's a kind of sacrifice. And that is how you are to act towards, I believe, your leader, your father. So, number one, dads are leaders, especially in spiritual matters. Number two, if you turn to 1 Timothy chapter 5, dads are providers. 1 Timothy chapter 5, the Apostle Paul is giving instructions dealing with widows, but then he throws in this very broad statement, and he says, but if anyone does not provide for his own, he's talking about his own family, especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. There's the sense where there's the ultimate responsibility in a home is on the dad being the provider. Now, there are obviously single moms, and there are situations where moms have to go at work, and the Bible never says a woman can't work outside the home. But look, the overarching emphasis is that the dad is the provider. And when we look at this concept in our culture today, it is something that is, I believe, hard. Because of several factors, we live in a very educated workforce, and then not everyone is cut out to be educated. So therefore, the father that isn't always feeling like, oh, I've got this degree or that degree, is gonna feel like they're up against it. And so we need to pray for dads that are in that situation. And then we live in a very materialistic world where you can see that we have a world that always wants the bigger house, bigger home, bigger vacation. And that does put pressure on fathers. And so I remember many years ago, 25 years ago, there was a man who came who always wore the same sweater. And yet, you would think, well, when I say he always wore the same sweater, there was like, man, do you ever change your clothes? Do you not have any other clothes? Somebody might think, but the reality of it is this man wasn't putting his money into his wardrobe. He was a man who was serving. He was always here. He was really faithful. And I look back and his children, I think, that are now adults and grandchildren, have always been very, very faithful. And so I want you to understand that dads are going to have pressure in this situation. We need to pray for them. And we need to support them when they don't make worldly decisions. And at times there's going to be decisions where, maybe the dad has to go out and get two jobs. I know that there's a lot of pressure to put the wife out in the workforce, But I've seen a lot of godly men, and I know as a pastor friend of mine talked about his own father, how when they needed more money, he went and got two jobs. And it's important that children see this. Now, at the same time, there is the reality that if a father is working 70, 80, 80 hours just for more, he's sacrificing against his family, and he's hurting his family. There is an article by a man named Edgar Guest that basically talks about the fact that that there's been a lot of wealthy men who were not successes of fathers. They made their money rapidly. They were, their factories were marvels of organization. Their money investments were sound and made with excellent judgment, and their contributions to public service were useful and willfully made. And all this took time and thought, but in the end, they never spent time with their children. And when these children were youngsters romping on the floor, if someone would have come to any of those fathers and offered them $1 million for his lad, he would have spurned the offer and kicked him out of his office. That if someone offered him $10 million in cash for the privilege of making a drunkard out of his son, the answer would have been the same. Had someone offered to buy him for a fortune the privilege of playing with the boy, of going on picnics and fishing trips and outings, and being with him every part of the day, he would have refused the proposition without giving a second thought. Yet this is the exact same bargain these men have made, which many men are still making. They are coining their lives into fortunes and automobile factories and great industries, but their boys are growing up as they may. And so how important it is for us to have a proper balance. So all of that works with the pressure that a dad has, as dads are providers. Third, turn to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians is talking a lot about roles of the family when you come to the practice of the believer. When you come to Ephesians 5:25, the Apostle Paul says, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her." This sets the tone for the family, the agape love that a father has for his wife. A dad is first a husband, and it's been said that the greatest gift a father could give his children is a love for his wife. The children see it. Now, we're not talking about a perfect husband. People make mistakes, but people who stay committed to one another, that makes a difference. And I saw it in my own family. My father wasn't always perfect, but I believe the love he had for my mother always made a difference in my life. I ran across some research that is, you would think, is incredibly obvious. It's by the Institute for Family Studies, and it's basically the headline of the research is, "Kids thrive when their parents are in love." Having parents in love is great for your kids. We've always known that being in a loving home is good for us, but it's not just the love of the parent towards the child that is important. Kids also do better when their parents love each other. And they cited one study with parents who loved each other. The kids stayed longer in school, had, I believe, a better married life. The recent study shows that more love between parents goes up, the more challenging behavior in the child goes down. And there's other studies as well. And I just think how important it is for us to have that emphasis. And we thank God for fathers that love their mothers. Fourth, we see it's important in Ephesians, if we're still in the book of Ephesians. In Ephesians chapter 6, it talks about, in verse 1, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." So this is a parental thing, but we don't want to leave it just to moms. We want dads to be involved. To obey means that the parents are instructing. And to be an instructor, you have to be involved. And this goes against sometimes the idea that a dad says, "Well, I'm just handing this over to the mom." And that is not what God wants. And again, with the balance of time and effort, a great business guru, Tom Peters, in his book Search for Excellence, when it was asked about the idea if a person could be excellent in the home and the office, he said no, because it takes time to excel at each, and it's a tough balance. And the reality of it is fathers, you've got to make the choice to be involved in your children's lives. You got to take initiative. And you got to take a stance. A child that runs roughshod over his dad, you know, becomes an adult that always gets their way, and you see many problems with that. But the idea of getting involved is that you've got to be there for your children. I ran across this article. It was called "Too Many Tomorrows." A man said, "I once asked my daughter Jennifer what she thought were the greatest, biggest problems fathers have with kids. And she said, dads have too many tomorrows. You know, I'll play with you tomorrow. I'll talk to you tomorrow. And she was right, the author said. Dad, be there now for your children, building quality and quantity benchmarks of trust. Don't wait until tomorrow or you'll end up wasting too many todays. And another article I ran across cited Charles Francis Adams, the 19th century political figure and diplomat. He kept a diary, and one day he wrote in his diary, went fishing with my son today, a wasted day. His son, Brooke Adams, also kept a diary, which has been found, and on the same day, Brooks Adams made this entry, went fishing with my dad, the most wonderful day of my life. The father thought he was wasting time with his son, but his son saw it as an investment of time. The only way to tell the difference between wasting and investing is to know one's ultimate purpose in life and to judge it accordingly. And that's why fathers, you need to be spending time with your children. You need to be involved in their life. The best dads get involved. And so dads instruct their children. Lastly, this is one that I think is very important, especially in our culture. Dads are overcomers. And what I mean by overcomers is what we all have been talking about. All have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God. If you turn your Bibles to Ezekiel 18, there is a reality that God knows that at one time the people of Israel were talking about all their problems, and it was all because of their fathers. And he says this in Ezekiel chapter 18, 1-3. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, what do you mean by using this proverb concerning the land of Israel, saying the fathers eat the sour grapes, but the children's teeth are set on edge? As I live, declares the Lord, you are surely not going to use this proverb in Israel anymore. And he goes on to talk about how the soul that sins dies. Basically, everyone is responsible. He goes through an incredible illustration of an ungodly father that ends up with a godly son, and a godly son that ends up with an ungodly child. I think that's the way it works. Basically, that as you work through the illustrations, the idea is it doesn't matter what your parent is. You're responsible for your own sin, your own actions. And what I think is when we look at our godly fathers, every father who is out there has had something done to them that's wrong, that's not good, that's not right. And yet, because God has said you can overcome this, the godly fathers are going to do just that. They're not going to live in their past. One author, a pastor named Scott Gibson, wrote, my father was an absentee father who was swept into a world of alcoholism. His absenteeism was palpable. From not spending time with his children to ignoring their safety while driving drunk, my father was not physically nor emotionally present. When he was around, he was angry or a raging drunk. I confess that I don't remember a pleasant moment with him. He was enveloped in a world of bitterness toward his own mother, who gave him birth while single, a truth he didn't learn until he was in his late teens. As a result, he turned his disappointments to anger, to alcohol. And yet, this pastor goes on to live a godly life and make an impact upon his own children. And I think for us today, it's important that, yes, I understand, you know, people can make a negative impact on you. But one of the things that we have as believers, and this is where godly fathers, they've come to know Jesus Christ as a Lord and Savior, and the power that's released in them can help them overcome their past. I'm not saying that the past is difficult to overcome. I'm saying that we can overcome it. And this is something that fathers can model for their family, that, and godly fathers do. That, look, I may not have had the best upbringing, but I can be different because of Christ in me. And so for all of us, there's the reality. You see the positive that a father can bring upon a family and demonstrate the changed life in himself, and then hopefully offer up the power to be living godly to his children with the idea of one thing, the gospel. And that's what we want the world to know, that all have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God. We've all done sin, and people have done sin against us, but there's hope in Jesus Christ. And I think Ezekiel 18 is a great passage of great hope, because otherwise someone could say, well, my life is shot. I've had this horrible upbringing. No, you can turn things around. You can be different. You can forget what lies behind, as the Apostle Paul talks about in Philippians chapter 3, and you can press on to the upward call in Christ Jesus. And so today, I'd encourage everyone to be a believer in Jesus Christ, everyone to recognize they're a sinner, that Jesus is God and man who died on the cross, who paid the penalty for their sins, and by faith alone, you can have eternal life, and you can have a born-again life because of Christ in you. So Father's Day 2024, when you're a dad, I like to say every day is Father's Day. And as we recognize today as children, we're honoring our dads. I hope every one of you had the opportunity to somehow communicate respect to your dad, love for your dad. Honor your dad every day. It's not just a holiday. Pray for your dad every day. And for dads, be a godly dad. Be a godly child for your dad every day. And so hopefully each and every day we'll have something special in the church of God. And my hope, my desire is that that our dads are honored today. I want to kindle on all of you when we look at dads are spiritual leaders, are leaders, especially in spiritual matters. They're providers, they're husbands, loving husbands. They're instructing other children, and they're overcomers. That we recognize these traits and we see them in our dads. And dads, I hope you're aspiring more and more to them. And always remember too, dads, you can't do this alone. You need Christ in you. And we all need Jesus. And I hope that today that we always remember we have the greatest Father, God the Father, and he's willing that all should come to him and all can get help from no matter where you're at, whether you're a father or whether you're a child. So God bless.